Mr. Neotia, Mr. Didar Singh, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure and privilege to be here in the midst of all of you on this very special occasion. Let me compliment Mr. Neotia on a very outstanding innings. And I also wish the incoming President, Mr. Patel, all the best and a great year at FICCI. Mr. Neotia wanted me to talk about digital payments. And we've had a big disruption in India's economy, but sometimes it's necessary to have creative disruptions. I think it's also important to take a long-term perspective and not get bogged down by what is happening in the near, in the immediate couple of days or couple of months as well. I think, to my mind, the worst cash shortage is almost nearing its end, or at least it should end by around mid-January, and we should reach a new normal. Prior to 9th November 2016, cash in circulation in India was around 17.54 trillion. I think we should assume that about 3.5 trillion out of this was pure black money and did not circulate at all. So minimally, about rupees 14 trillion was being used to conduct legitimate transactions. Therefore, assuming that the need for cash can be reduced by digitization of transactions, and I'll talk about that, and my view is that India is quite prepared for digitization of transactions, though it may take some time, we should be able to reduce the need for cash by about 2.5 to 3 trillion over a period of time. And to my mind, we need about 12 trillion in cash to finance normal levels of transaction. I think we should be able to get this there by about mid to end January. This leaves us with about roughly about 4 trillion short of cash. And given the bulk of the additional, new cash will be in denomination of rupees 500 or less. This 4 trillion will be significantly longer to inject than the first couple of trillions that have been injected. But sustaining about a 7.5% or higher growth with cash, the challenge is that you need to sustain this growth rate of about 7.6% growth, with cash dropping to about 12 trillion, would really require substantial digitization of transactions. India is a country with about 86% cash. Now, the government's objective is that while you're reducing cash in the economy, you should push for digitization. And to my mind, in the immediate short run, while government is one way trying to remonetize the economy, it is also trying to push for digitization of economy. The rationale being that if India is to become a $10 trillion economy, India can't have a $2 trillion formal economy and a $1 trillion informal economy, which thrives on black money. If India is to become a $10 trillion economy, then it has to push for formalization of the economy. And this cannot be if it continues to have 86% cash. Some people say that this has severely impacted business transactions. Yes, I accept that. That it'll be impacted in one quarter, it'll be impacted in two quarters. But India is not a corporate company. We don't have to give out corporate results every corporate, like most of you do. I think India needs to take an annual perspective on how India is going to grow. And India needs to take a longer term perspective on how it needs to grow. And if greater amount of liquidity coming into the banking system, if it leads to reduction of fiscal deficit, and in the long run, if it leads to lowering of inflation, if it leads to lowering of taxation, and if it leads to creating a new equilibrium in the Indian economy, which would enable funds to flow for infrastructure sector at lower rates of interest for longer tenures, then I think in the long run, it is necessary that India formalizes its economy. It's important to do that because there is no way India can be a $10 trillion economy with a huge parallel economy. And therefore, it is necessary that India takes some disruptionist measures. This is a strong measure. This is a tough measure. A lot of journalists and a lot of businessmen used to say that the mandate was for change and the mandate was for big bang reforms. But my feeling is that journalists and businessmen don't have the gumption and the courage to take on big bang reforms. And when big bang reforms happen, then businessmen and journalists are the first one to say that the country is not prepared for it. And therefore, if the political system whose mandate is to bring big bang reforms takes big bang reforms, which require a certain level of secrecy, then it is taking a long-term perspective. And I would also say that the political system has actually radically taken a decision which has impacted its own vote bank. It has severely impacted its own vote bank. And therefore, I think we need to appreciate the courage behind a bold decision of this nature. But my view is that a decision of this nature of demonetizing the Indian economy actually needs to be backed by several measures, other measures as well. Because farmers have shown great resilience in coping with the cash shortage. And I think there are excellent prospects that the current Kharif crop can be a very good one. And therefore, we need to support them through various measures. And we can talk about this. But we need to also take measures, go beyond demonetization to bring in radical reforms in real estate. This is an important area where black money is created, and there are sources of generation of black money in the sector that needs severe plugging. The existing high rates of stamp duty need rationalization. The high capital gain tax, and I think we need to rationalize that. The real estate sector is capable of very large generation of employment, and therefore reforms are necessary in the real estate sector. There is an imperative need for tax simplification. There's an imperative need of tax rate reduction and tax codification. And all this will, in the long run, lead to predictability, consistency and clarity of policies, which India needs, because its ambition and hunger is to grow at even higher rates of 9 to 10% over a three-decade period. And therefore, you need to do this. So, and the third is election financing. And I think financing of election gives rise to black money, and therefore, you need major steps in curbing black money, and we need to plug all legal loopholes in the election systems. So real estate sector needs radical reforms, election sector needs radical reforms, tax simplification, tax codification, you need simplicity, you need consistency, predictability, all this is essential. Now, how do we ensure that we have almost the shortfall in currency? Because if you are able to, if your objective is to bring back $17.54 trillion in trillion rupees in cash, you'll again create a parallel economy. The minute you have cash, India's psyche is to create black economy. Indians have got used, it's become a part of their blood with the, and I think Indians must accept this, that Indians have got habituated to creating black money. So the minute you have cash, you will create black economy, whether we like it or not. And therefore, it's necessary that we ensure that there are, the liquidity of cash is kept to that bare minimum of 11 to 12 trillion. And beyond that, Indians must move towards digitization. It's essential, because you can't survive, you can't grow into a $10 trillion economy without digitization. Now, how do you formalize it? You can formalize it because the back-end structure is very strong. India is the only country in the world with a billion biometric. And it's a phenomenal infrastructure that has been created. India is the only country in the world which has a billion mobile. No other country in the world has that. And using these two and the vast number of bank accounts that have been created as a part of the Jam Trinity, it is possible for India to technology leapfrog. And my view is that in the next 3 years, it is possible for India to bypass the entire debit card, credit card, ATMs, POS machines, and make a quantum jump. And India is in for very major disruption in the digital payment mechanisms. You would recall, many of you would recall, that government had launched major drive for financial inclusion in terms of opening Jandhan accounts, giving a statutory basis for Aadhaar, implementation of direct benefits transfer across state governments, and it has led to some very fascinating results when the direct benefit transfer was implemented even in a state like Kerala. They realized that actually there were 34,000 teachers who did not actually exist on the, but were getting their pays. And therefore, there are huge stoppages of leakages by implementation of direct benefit transfer. There was introduction of RuPay cards and voluntary disclosure scheme for, subsequently a voluntary disclosure scheme for unaccounted money. Now, what digitization, there are five very easy, simple ways of making digital transactions in India today. And our strategy is that there are about 30 crore Indians without a mobile, So first strategy is that how do you enable people without a mobile to do transactions in a digital manner? If you go, I'd just been to Jharkhand and I traveled extensively in Jharkhand. And out of 23,000 ration shops, 20,000 ration shops have a POS machine. And if you go to parts of Andhra Pradesh, particularly Krishna district and West Godavari districts, every single transaction the merchants do through the ration shop has a POS machine. You go, you feed your Aadhaar number, that is the only thing you need to remember. You put your thumb impression or your iris, one of the two, and that cannot be replicated, so there's no problem, no issue of cyber security. So you put your thumb impression. You get a roll down of different banks. You just name the bank where your account is. So if you say State Bank of India, it'll take you straight into your account. The POS machine also in a mechanical manner weighs your rations, so it's 100% mechanized, the weighing of rations, so there's no leakage there. It takes you to your bank account, you just feed your amount and do a debit or credit. And actually all farmers and everybody in Krishna and West Godavari districts are today doing cashless transactions. Everyone is doing all cashless transactions, and the ration shop dealers are all banking correspondents as well. So they give money to the farmers, and it's all transacted. Whenever they need money, small money, it's all transacted, and it's a debit or credit to their bank account. So it's all cashless transaction. And every single state of India is moving in that direction. And the big disruption will be that Aadhaar-enabled payment will enable every single mobile, every single smartphone. It's not just the POS machine, but every single mobile in India. Each one of you who has a smartphone, in about a year's time, or even less probably, because the software is ready, the TCS has made this software, which is interoperable. It's an open interoperable system. You just put a small device here, where you put your thumb impression, and you put your Aadhaar number, and you can do a debit or credit in a bank. So each one of us will actually be a walking ATM in the next 6 to 7 months. Each one of us will be a walking ATM using your Aadhaar number, and just doing debit credit. So if somebody here wants cash, I can actually do that transaction for him here and lend him money and get it actually credited to my account or debited to my account, whatever. So each one of us in 6 months' time, 7 months' time, and that is the big, big disruption which will happen in India through Aadhaar. So that is a strategy for people who do not even have a mobile. The next segment is about another 30 crore Indians who have a phone, but not a smartphone. They have a GSM phone. They have a GSM phone. You don't need connectivity. You can do a transaction. You don't need internet connectivity. But today, you can do a transaction using *99#. Use *99#, generate an MPIN. Your mobile needs to be linked to your bank account, and you can do a transaction straight away on that. And that is straight away from a GSM phone. And the next layer are people who have smartphones, and that's about close to 400 crore Indians who have a phone. And the 40 crore Indians who have a phone. And these are people who can do any amount of transaction using either unified payment interface. And unified payment interface is an open interoperable system which the banks have created. Banks have created, it's managed by the NPCI, the National Payment Corporation of India. You can do any transaction on the back of UPI. You can do USSD, that is *999#, or you can do download any wallet. You can download any wallet, or you can do Aadhaar-enabled payment. Or India has 80 crore debit cards, out of which only about 40 to 44 crores debit cards are actually in use. And most of us educated Indians have been using our debit cards only for withdrawing cash from ATM machines. You should use your debit card for doing all transactions, not just withdrawing cash. And therefore, there are five different ways: debit card, credit cards, prepaid cards. There are also prepaid cards. Many of you pay your laborers. If you want to pay your laborers or contractors who are paying their laborers in the field and having a problem, if you're finding it difficult to open their bank account, please pay them through prepaid cards. So prepaid cards, debit card, credit cards. There are wallets, a huge number of wallets. In wallets, you are taking money out of the bank account into the wallet. And from wallet, you're transferring money. So wallet is a very easy mechanism, but in reality, you take money out of your bank account. And you are not getting interest when you put money into the wallet. And from wallet, you are doing bang, bang, bang payments. It's very easy to do that. So in my phone, actually, I have UPI, I have a wallet, and I do my all my bank-to-bank transfers I do using all this, which I've been doing internet banking, I've been doing for quite some time. So I have all three, but I can also do *99# from here, all four. Now, these are different ways of digital transactions. They are extremely easy and simple to do. And I would request all of you to kindly master these. They're very, very easy, very, very simple. And if you want, I'll send a team from NITI Aayog to train all of you. And it's important that each one of you who belong to the rich elite class, you know, you're all big money bags, big elite class, so it's important that all of you learn and master this art of doing this. And if you do it, you please learn the art of training another 10 people. And I was pleasantly surprised that in a place like Jharkhand, every single policeman now has been trained to do this. Over 100,000 of policemen have been trained to do this, and they in turn are training 10 people each. I was pleasantly surprised to see that 140,000 students who had qualified for the science and technology tests, and they've all been made into change agents for digital payment. I was very pleasantly surprised that the entire civil defense force has actually been converted into a digital army by the Jharkhand government. And exactly the same thing is happening in Chhattisgarh, exactly the same thing is happening in all union territories, and there's a big movement. But I find it quite amazing that in Lutyens, Delhi, in the heart of Delhi, particularly in Chanakyapuri, people just don't want to get moving with digital transaction. And it's the same Lutyens, Delhi, which had at one point of time said that the poor people of India will not be able to handle their mobile phones, and every single poor person handles a mobile phone very effectively. They had said that poor people will not be able to handle debit credit cards. They had said that poor people will not be able to handle ATM machines. They've all learned that art. And my belief is that actually the poor people of India will learn the art of digital transaction much quicker, much faster than the rich elite class of Lutyens, Delhi. And therefore, the challenge really is whether all of you, the FICCI executive and the FICCI elite class, can learn the art of digital transaction and actually become the change agents for India. And if you become the change agent of India, I'll recognize that FICCI is doing a good job. But to encourage, you know, since digital transaction is very slow in Delhi, and in particularly with the rich elite class of FICCI, the government has announced two special schemes for FICCI members. You know, One of them is called the Lucky Grahak Yojana, and the other is called the Digi Dhan Vyapari Yojana. And the intention of government is that all FICCI members who do digital transaction can get a cash back for the next 100 days. They are also entitled on weekly draws to get 1,50,000 and 25,000. And many FICCI members will also, who get onto digital transaction, will also be entitled to 1 crore in the mega draw to be held on April 14th. So it's a big, big initiative. But I visualize that the important thing is a movement of this nature essentially has to be driven by two things. One is that in India, when you withdraw money from ATM, there's no tax or there's no charge on it. But when you do a digital transaction, you end up paying from 1.5 to 2% varying. And these fees were designed when India's volumes of digital transaction were low. So it was a low volume, high charge model. Low volume, high charge model. Now, as India moves to a high volume transactions, as the volumes grow, and since 8th November, volumes have grown, and I'll give you the figure, volumes have, in RuPay cards, the transactions have grown by 316%. In e-wallet, they've grown by 271%. In UPI, they've grown by 119%. In USSD, that is the poor people of India, they've grown by 1,202%. And in POS machines, they've grown by 95%. That's the growth from 8th November, as of yesterday. So, as you move into higher volume, your cost of transaction, you should move to a high volume, low transaction cost model. And therefore, the merchant discount rate, which is fairly high, should actually fall. MDR should fall radically. And that will happen in due course. But one of the things government has done is to provide incentives. The finance minister has announced 11 different incentives. But in the long run, government's intention is to make cash handling more expensive and digital transaction extremely cheap. So there should be no, to my mind, there should be no transaction cost on digital payment, and there should be a cess on cash handling. And that is the way economy will move. That is the way economy will move if you want to push digital transaction. And once that happens, and that will happen shortly because the push towards digital transaction is so heavy, once that happens, then the market forces will take over. And market forces will then drive the digitization of Indian economy, and that's a matter of, to my mind, just a couple of months away, when market forces will take over. But moving to new technology needs a change of mindsets. And therefore, the challenge is for market to take over, you need a lot of onboarding of merchants. And unless merchants don't become the change agent, because merchants you onboard, and merchants in turn will onboard consumers. Because when you go to Khan Market and do shopping, the merchant will tell you that, no sir, I don't want to do a digital transaction, I want to do cash. I want cash. And he says that, because he's been doing that for the last 5 to 6 years, he's lived all his life on cash transaction and he doesn't disclose it. So when you push him towards digital transaction, which the government is trying to do, his mind fear is that actually the income tax people will open up my accounts. Suddenly I see a 5-fold, 6-fold, 10-fold increase in transaction cost for this year. The income tax people will open up my account books for the last previous 5 to 6 years and start doing survey and tax rate. That's his mindset. Now, what the government has done is to issue a clear circular that all those who move towards digital transaction, their account books will not be opened. They'll not be subjected to any survey or tax. And this circular has been issued day before by the Revenue Department that they'll not be subjected to this tax, any kind of tax harassment, those who move towards. So what the government is attempting to do is to move towards a market economy where market enables people to move towards digital payments. And we've announced some incentives. We've announced this huge Lucky Grahak Yojana and Digidhan Vyapari Yojana. And government will in the next 2-3 months spend about 340 crores to push people towards digital payments. We will push for greater level of merchant onboarding. We will push for greater level of consumer onboarding towards digital payments. And we will push digitization in a manner where young people, our students, our IIT professors, our IIT teachers, and 4 million people who are trained in software today become the change agents of India. But let me assure you, ladies and gentlemen, that the back end is all there. The back end is all there. The technology is all there. It's very easy. It's very simple to operate. It's all based on a very sound security transaction basis because it's all two-factor authentication. And its technology is easy and simple. The challenge is to change your mindset, be the change that you want to be, and FICCI should lead this change for a digital India. And that is the only way India can become a $10 trillion formal economy. Don't worry about the short term of one quarter, two quarter. Look at a 30-year perspective of India growing at rates of 9 to 10% per annum, year after year, year after year. And that cannot happen with a black economy, which is equivalent to the size of your formal economy. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.